everybody. This is Pastor Brian. End of October. And in the church year, that's always exciting because of so much begins. Reformation Sunday, the anniversary of, well, the beginning of the Reformation. as Brother Martin nails the 95 arguments on the church door, and on the one hand, I think it's somewhat humorous. The ego, the position of Martin, and wanting to put these 95 points in which to discuss and argue and move along about, but still basically to think that here is this university professor from Wittenberg, Germany, who thinks that this will get to Rome, and the Pope will say, well, thank you, Brother Martin, for bringing this to our attention, and by all means, we'll make these changes. And so it began. And certainly the beauty of the printing press and getting the Bible and theology into the hands of the people, certainly all of that. Anyway, all of that is wrapped up in the end of October. And then in the church year, now we move to All Saints. And as we recognize those loved ones of us who have passed from us in this year, and by all means, we are locked into this depth of numbers from this terrible virus and our precautions to be safe. But for those who were with us and laughing with us and celebrating life with us just months ago and are now absent from us forever. And so we are mindful of that as we move now into All Saints Sunday. And in many congregations, we'll be ringing a bell and reading off names. And it is that memory for all saints to remember who we are. The traditional text for us of All Saints is the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, and so as we open this up, just as a refresher, go to Matthew chapter 4 and to put this into place. And so understanding that when Jesus is preaching to the people, it is, you see, in Matthew, it is after, it certainly moves, the birth of Jesus, and then in chapter 3, all of a sudden, we have grown-up Jesus, and we have John the Baptist, who is doing his work, and the baptism of Jesus, chapter 3, and right after the baptism of Jesus, we move into the temptation of Jesus, his days, 40 days, 40 nights in the wilderness, and he is tempted, and some of this work here. And obviously the preaching point of Jesus' temptation is then to ask you, what is your desert and how are you tempted? That's where we go with the temptation of Jesus, is to make it personal to you. And we come back, and now Jesus out of the desert, and he begins to preach and teach, and the calling of the first disciples. And so here we have the beginnings now. So this is Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. So it is early in the ministry of Jesus as he begins, and as he begins to teach. Now, of these 8, 9 lifted up here, blessed are the poor, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek, blessed are those who hunger, etc. Now, we must pause, you know, in this introduction. And since this is a Bible study Sunday school class, this is not worship and this is not a sermon. The point of this is to share in this devotional conversation with you. This is not, the Beatitude is not a list of how to be a Christian. All theologians recognize this. I hope and believe that most pastors and preachers realize this. This is not the recipe of how to become a Christian. There is nothing here about how to become a Christian. This distinction must be made in the Beatitudes. Well, what are they then? These are the fruits of the Spirit that are manifested in the heart of a Christian already. This is how we must look at the Beatitudes, fruits of the Spirit, how this is. Because, you see, if this is moved into a recipe of how to be a Christian, well, then you get into this whole thing of, well, pull your metaphorical Christian self up by your bootstraps and do it yourself. The recipe is right here. Here, this is it. And in fact, early on, you see in Matthew 4, verse 17, Jesus says, "Repent, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." All right, well, how am I supposed to repent? How am I supposed to? You see, we can slip into this recipe formula of, well, this is how I'm supposed to be a Christian. No, not at all. Then we have to say, well, then what happens? We move into the, you have been saved by faith alone, not by your works. And so if the Beatitudes turn into a works righteousness formula, then we're going down the wrong trail completely. Emphasize again, underline it, take your yellow highlighter. This is not the recipe on how to be a Christian. This is the fruit of the Spirit of an already Christian, to have this desire to seek and to move and to be into the Spirit and fellowship of Jesus Christ. This is how this works, because we all understand what happens with denominations, preachers, churches, who turn this into you better, you must, this is how you should, and how to be very careful against that theology and preaching and teaching, and we turn into a Pharisee very quick. This is just how that will happen when you turn it into a business of works. And so if, as you then were to read and continue chapter 5, Jesus teaches quite a bit, and it goes through chapter 6 into chapter 7, and the teaching. So if in fact you do have one of those Bibles with the red letters, the words of Jesus printed in red, you're going to see a whole lot of Matthew 5, 6, and 7 as Jesus is teaching about the fruits of the Spirit, how to love, how to be, and how to hold on to this. And now in our remaining time, what I wanted to shift into is, pardon me, is Philippians chapter 3. And why Philippians chapter 3? It is this lovely, tender, warm, this is a reinforcing letter from Paul to you in your faith, in your life of the Spirit. And so you see, for all saints, for those that we can lift up, for those who that we have celebrated their life, that we have had their funeral, that we have had their burial and their interment. We have put them to rest. And in our hope of these people who have lived in Christ, who have lived their life in faith, and from this we understand, they have grasped this concept of sola fide, and this doctrine of justification by faith, who have been made righteous by faith. And so here in Philippians chapter 3, and it goes through the first verse actually of chapter 4. You see, it begins, chapter 4, verse 1, "Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, that is how you should stand firm in the Lord, dear friends." Okay, so chapter 4, verse 1 begins with the therefore. And so whenever you come to a therefore, you say, what is it therefore? Well, verse 3. "Finally, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you." Okay. Down to verse 7, since we only have just a few minutes. "But whatever was my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For those sakes I have lost all these things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. I become like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead." And so here, so dear loved ones, in our memory and in our anticipation of All Saints Sunday, we have once again lifting up the doctrine of justification, sola fide, to you, loved ones, be all honor, grace, and glory. In the name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, this is Pastor Brian. Thank you so much. God bless. Be safe for one and all. Bye-bye.